my tech here, but the purposes of the video, we've got to be plugged in for sound recording here. MBBS is Bachelor of Medicine and Bachelor of Surgery. And you've got to then, after 6 years of medical school, earn the degree of MD, Doctor of Medicine. So to become a doctor in Australia, your MBBS. If you're going to be a surgeon, then you earn the title when you've got your boards in surgery of becoming Mr. But anyway, Sydney's home. I did not, bring my slides of Sydney, Australia, but it's a Western society and we have colon cancer, the same problem. And what I was wanting to do today was look at where we are, and I would say we're at a stone wall, and look at where our understanding of a disease, our disease is, and how that impacts on new strategies to make an impact on colon cancer. If I could have the first slide, please. Do I have remote control for advancing slides? We can work microphones and flashy pointers, but not slide projectors. So what we're going to do today is there a way I can get these two front lights down?
I'm not sure if there are the front adjustment. I can't get it.
It's one down.
I hate to turn them all off. People get very sleepy.
Well, there's coffee down the back.
Okay.
I'll do a song and dance if people go to sleep. So what we've really got is some very exciting times. I just came back from a conference in Houston at the MD Anderson. And the MD Anderson, they have an annual pathology conference. And basically, it's 7 years since they've discussed colon cancer. 7 years ago, the conference focused on probably the stone wall that we're at right now. What the conference focused on this year was topic called chemo prevention. And I would include as part of that definition of chemo prevention is the diet. So there is some very interesting work going on, which we're part of here at the hospital. And I was going to, and actually here in San Antonio, in collaboration with the Rook Army Medical Center and with the Wilfred Hall Medical Center, Medical Center Hospital here at the county and also at the VA. We're part of that program, and what I'm going to develop today is our thesis and our understanding of where a small group, now a critical mass in the country, is going towards this topic of prevention, and I might call it chemo prevention because there are pharmaceutical agents in there as well. I was going to share some of that information. Can we just probably get it up one little bit? Because when we look at disease, and as I say, we've probably stonewalled it as far as colon cancer is concerned. Oh, okay, you're right. When we're talking about disease prevention, and this is a new concept, and it's a new concept both in healthcare and medical school education, we're looking at several levels. And to try and get it in perspective, and I see that some folks here have public health degrees, these are the three levels that we're looking at. First is health promotion. And my area is of training is clinical nutrition. And so I have an interest down here, rather than down here at chopping out colon cancer, and maybe not having excellent results. When we're talking about health promotion, we're talking about basic lifestyle activities. We're looking at things that each of us has control over, each of us can undertake to reduce our risk for developing disease. And this is taken off in one area, coronary artery disease, and it's now about time, and we've got scientific basis to go forward in cancer prevention. One of those areas is colon cancer. So I think we'll be developing some information about general population strategies, and that'll probably be the take-home message. But what is concrete is where we are in 1993 with these other goals of what's called, firstly, primary prevention. And that is to reduce the disease incidence. The incidence for colon cancer is stonewalled, and I'll give you some numbers shortly. In the general population, Australia and the United States, we're stonewalled. It hasn't changed for a long period of time. Obviously, the goals are to reduce premature death from colon cancer, and I'll share with you some statistics describing colon cancer and where we're stonewalled. Obviously, those of us who are in healthcare settings are aware of this third aspect of prevention, and that is the threat to health. Colon cancer has significant morbidity. Those of you who have cared for patients with colon cancer are more than aware of the burdens of colon cancer. And particularly, and why it's appropriate today, is I believe it's a preventable disease, and if early detected, we can make a major impact. So that disease incidence and premature death, yes, you've got to die of something, and I'm not quite sure what our genetic program is, but I would rather not die of colon cancer. And really, those of you who have training in public health realize that overall there are some strategies there to protect health, both of its members and as Western society was concerned, of our community. Yes, ma'am.
Does Crohn's syndrome and diverticulitis fall in this category?
No. Crohn's disease is a disease, again, of unknown etiology. It's an inflammatory bowel disease and has little risk associated with colon cancer. However, the other form of inflammatory bowel disease affecting the colon called ulcerative colitis has marked predisposition towards colon cancer, and I'm going to be addressing what we've learned from that and how we can go forward to applying it both to the general population and those at higher risk. Lastly, and that's where we're at now, is secondary prevention, namely those who've got the disease, can we change the course of it? And that's what we call here, and for those of you who can't read, is reduction of prevalence by early detection. And we actually have in place studies that have documented the impact of screening and the impact that this has on colon cancer. So to me, there is big hope for the future. I don't want to build up your hopes because this is a long line, a long timeline, and the next slide will show you what the timeline is. And these are the strategies for those of you who've done public health. And can everyone read or not? At the back. This is severity. This pointer is not doing well by me. This is where we think strategies for early detection picking. And this is screening and the natural history of disease. And whenever disease develops, and we're talking about patients with, for example, ulcerative colitis, between onset of ulcerative colitis and following time down here, the timeline is about 15 years. A very significant proportion of patients with ulcerative colitis come 15 years, become a statistic. What we have in here, and these dotted lines, is perhaps what prevention, and the form of prevention is screening or early detection, has to offer. And can we modulate this line by strategies? And this would therefore apply for intervention by identifying populations at high risk. In general principles, when we talk about screening, do we do it in everybody or are we selective? And where we're at now is we have a disease, colon cancer, that is a significant health problem in the community, and I'll give you the numbers shortly. We have the means to detect early colon cancer potentially. And is it important? Yes, there's a significant mortality down here from the disease. Can we do it in everybody? No, not everybody gets colon cancer. Therefore, screening strategies can be directed, one, at the general population, or two, at high-risk categories. And each of us in this room are over the age of 40, 50, and that's who gets colon cancer. There is a small group, and we'll talk about those just in passing, because it has shared some light on disease, but they're in the minority who develop colon cancer before the age of 40. And they would therefore be requiring a lot of effort for screening because they are considered high-risk group. And that's first-degree relatives of patients who've had colon cancer, patients with hereditary polyposis and other syndromes, hereditary syndromes, and we'll have a look at that list shortly. So we are now in place, have strategies for screening that can be focused on high-risk populations. Furthermore, the question is, so what? And so what is that we've got to have cost-effective issues for intervention. And this is going to be a major burden on the healthcare system when it comes to colon cancer. And this is why some of us want to go back further down in the natural history of disease, and that's why we're going to talk a little bit about the theory of colon cancer. So this is the paradigm now. This is where we're at as far as our level of care is in the cancer statistics. This is where we're at potentially without screening and picking up patients with disease because of treatment modalities, surgery, chemotherapy, radiation. Where we'd like to be is this M with S, or screening, medical care after early screening here, and make an impact on the natural history of the disease in our community. And O is basically what we would call the latent period. Namely, we are exposed to all sorts of things, some of which will be elaborated today, for many years prior to developing colon cancer. So we have an opportunity during this exposure period, during the development of the disease, to modulate. And that can slow down the rate of progression of disease towards death, or can bottom it out and eliminate disease. What the expectations are is the challenge of research to try and identify. But this is the concepts in which I'll be talking about colon cancer this morning. Any comments or questions about this sort of background information about disease prevention? So we're actually getting into a very exciting mode. People who monitor medical school education, for example, in 1993, want to know how much in our curriculum we have on disease prevention. So it's rather than us talking down here about chopping things out and chemotherapy, we're now focusing down here, although it's small hours in the curriculum compared with everything else that we learn in medical school, because in medical school we're trained to take care of disease down this end of the line. What is interesting about colon cancer is the question, who gets it? And I see indicated in the overall paradigm is that it's sporadic. And by sporadic, we're looking at environmental factors, namely, we in this room have a chance of getting colon cancer. And those of you who have been exposed to epidemiology will realize that we can use populations. We can use populations to ask the question, who gets cancer? And what are the etiological factors? And this gentleman is an Englishman, Dole and Pito, and he, in 1981, prepared a report for the Office of Technology Assessment in the United States and looked at the US population from an epidemiologist's point of view. And this is globally again for cancer. And in 1981, this is the etiological factors or environmental factors that he coined the term cancer avoidability. Namely, these are the things that you and I have control over potentially. And this is where we're spending a lot of our time today, the dietary factors. And this is overall cancer, and I'd venture to say that some people suggest with colon cancer, the diet is a much more significant component than with respect to all cancers. Tobacco smoking, we've heard a lot about, and we've seen a lot done. In certain high-risk populations, well, I'm not going to say certain high-risk populations, certain populations exposed to tobacco, there's been a decline in cancer deaths, namely lung cancer in males. But in females, we still see cancer of the lung going up. Ergo, this concept of periods of exposure, while the incidence of smoking may still be very high in females, females didn't start till later, after World War II. So these populations with long exposure to cancer, to smoking or cancer risk, are now kicking in as far as the mortality is concerned. So tobacco smoking is a good one-third of all cancer deaths. There's still many questions for what is unknown. Alcohol, again, a lifestyle component, has a significant association with cancer in general. Certain occupations have been well identified, and the occupational hazards are certainly there. There are certainly many questions and uncertainties in various areas, but most have been well defined. But obviously, the world is changing, and the carcinogens out there are vast. But that is a factor that perhaps is overrated. Our epidemiologists look at occupation contributing to around about 4% of avoidable factors, and that's why we see major interventions in those areas. Pollution, again, only about 2%. Geophysical factors, I'm not quite sure what Pito or Dole described overall for cancer. Reproduction habits is basically the story of cervical cancer. And actually, the reproductive habits of women, those who are nulliparous, have increased risk for colon cancer. Medical therapies, whatever we do, can contribute to cancer. But overall, the big chunk of the pie for potential impact on disease prevention is dietary factors. And Dr. Dole, he's a PhD, so he's not a mister or anything like that, and he comes from Oxford, has made a major impact from his analysis, and that's a book that's available in 1981. So where is the stone wall? This is the picture of colon cancer, and colon cancer is not only the colon. I'm sure everyone's familiar with what the colon looks like, from the cecum around to the rectum, and perhaps the rectum is a little bit different to the rest of the colon, and perhaps the left and the right are different when it comes to colon cancer, but that's where we're at now in teasing things out. In countries such as Japan, they're saying now there's a shift to the right when it comes to colon cancer, but this is just maybe some speculation as to why this should be. But colon cancer, overall, when it comes to the bottom line of as far as disease, our top paradigm, this is these closed triangles up the top are white males, and this is timeline. Can you see down there? This is 1952. This is 1976, 1980. And I can tell you the latest cancer statistics, 1992. The line hasn't changed. these closed circles. So this is a age standard mortality rate, and this is 26 per 100,000, the general population for colorectal cancer. Down here, the triangles are non-white males and perhaps going up. But as you can see, the range is from about 16, 17 to 26. The US population on average is around about here, and it hasn't gone down. This is the females going down from 1952 of 25, 1976 around about 20. So there has been perhaps in females this period of time a little bit of a decrease, but overall in 1992 this may have come up, and I'll share the males and female statistics. This is overall cancer again before we get back to colon cancer, and this is where colon and rectum fits in, and this is cancer deaths, the difference between males and females. Number one, obviously lung cancer and smoking. Number two, in males, prostate cancer. Number two in females, 46,000. This is mortality rate. Disease incidence, the new cases in 1993 is in the order of about 170,000 cases in the US. And this is the mortality rate. So 28,000 versus 93,000 as far as the death certificate is concerned. Overall, males and females equal. And there's really been very little teased out as to a difference between males and females. And actually in females, it may be after the age of age of probably about 55, males and females definitely are equal. Less than the age of 55, females actually have it a little bit higher when it comes to overall mortality from colon cancer. So there is a difference. So these environmental factors summarized out for colon cancer, and this is 1992 numbers, and that's combining those two populations for males and females, 61,000. And what are the risk factors? One, a high fat diet, low fiber diet, Western living. The mean age for colon cancer is age of 60. So it is a major, major disease in the elderly, and that's why we're talking about it here today. Genetics, yes, but only 10%, and that's where a lot of excitement is. You don't get a grant in 1993 if you don't have something about genetics and molecular biology. So we've discussed already inflammatory bowel disease. So these are risk factors. The relative importance of this environmental factor, and that's what we'd call the cancer avoidability, is in the order of anywhere from 60 to 90% contributing, and we'll have a look at some numbers shortly. This genetic group is only about 10% of the cancer population. The inflammatory bowel disease is about 1% of this number here, of the colon cancer. Where are they important? They're important because they give us insight. They give us insight into the mechanisms for developing cancer, and that's where we'll be spending a fair bit of time today. So what do we know? We know that it's very important to test the stool for blood screening. Who should be screened? Those at risk. Who are at risk? Those over the age of 50. So there are now recognized strategies for patient care, and I think in the new health plan, preventative health care is going to be reimbursed. And there's a burden. How do you get it? You can self do a card, and we'll talk about that shortly, or a digital exam for the rectum, because majority of cancers are actually in the rectum and the distal intestine. And that's why we also would recommend what's called proctoscopy or flexible sigmoidoscopy. And I'm just going to extend the argument to colonoscopy. Colonoscopy means going all the way around to the cecum. $600 a pop, how many colonoscopies should every adult over the age of 50 have? I'll leave you with that challenge. So that's why some of us want to look further down. But as you can see, there are some questions here. There are some strategies and how efficacious they are. I'll be sharing some data with this morning. That's what we know about cancer, and that's what we know about colon cancer. These others certainly are important, but I really believe today we have some major challenges to do better with colon cancer. Overall for cancer again, as far as disease is concerned, coronary artery disease is still number one, but for everyone born in 1985, about 25% will have a cancer death. And as Dr. Dole pointed out, a lot of this is potentially avoidable. Again, latency exposure, if you want to call it, our understanding of cancer is carcinogen, and then detectable disease is in the order of 20 to 30 years. And this is why colon cancer is a very nice paradigm, is that there is there are lesions along the way that we can pick up, and I'm going to share how this is going to impact upon the contributions to prevention. And this bottom line, where does colon cancer fit in for all of these deaths? In the order, it ranks number three to lung, prostate, and breast. But it is still worth chipping away at cancer deaths, because within colon cancer, there's a significant potential for intervention. Can you see that? Okay. This is the stone wall and what we have to offer when we've screened a patient and detected disease. And so what is very important at surgery, and this is why we spend a lot of time, is staging the disease. And the stages are Dukes A and B, is where we have a very good result. This filled line is the natural history for the population 6 years after the treatment. So that is what is expected for the population. If you're up there, and we are with treatment, then we've cured the cancer. So that's Dukes A and B, but they're the minority. If it's Dukes B2, namely it's spread beyond the colon mucosa, Dukes C and D, very, very abysmal results. Dukes C and D, namely, depends upon how many lymph nodes are involved. And if it's less than three, then we're down here at a survival rate of around about 55%, 5 years down the line. If greater than four nodes are involved, survival rate of about 20%. So staging at the time of surgery is important for prognosis. What is important is that we've got to try and get everyone up into this ballpark if we're going to continue with the best chance of surgery. Any questions? So early detection is empirical. Other treatment modalities available to us are still not good, and this is chemotherapy and radiotherapy. And patients without recurrence, namely this is offered up front with surgery, this is what we're looking at years after randomization, either to combination chemotherapy and radiation or radiation alone. They probably do a little better, but again, we're looking around about 50-55%. And that is of the minority, because you don't get these if you have Dukes A or B. So what we have to offer is to the majority of patients with colon cancer is not good news, and the survival rate is in the order at 5 years around about 55%, and that's overall survival. So we have a major imperative to have early detection. So this is the problem.
As I've indicated, there's a myriad of syndromes here, the hereditary polyposis. Is that enough light for everyone? Are you going to stay awake or what? Okay. And these we won't talk about other than to say that they're very interesting. Unfortunately, these people just, if you go into the colon and have a look at it, it's just polyps. It's like clusters of grapes lining the colon. I'm sorry I didn't bring a picture. Unfortunately, a lady about 45 in the last couple of months had her colon removed, because what happens to these folks is that in some of those polyps, they develop cancer. You can't just remove them all. They have thousands of polyps. There's a whole series of syndromes there, and that's called familial adenosis polyposis syndromes. There's other syndromes there. There are some cancer syndromes that don't have polyps, and they can develop colon cancer, and they are people who run in families. And there are people studying these groups of families from Utah. And the reason they study them from Utah is that they have very good genealogy. The Mormons have made available their family records. Not only do they have good genealogy, but they have many rats in their laboratory, so to speak. And they take these families and go around and get the cancer statistics and sometimes get the tissue and undergoing studies to help us understand this sporadic colorectal cancer, which is 90% of the cancer story. These, while in big print here, when I remade the slide the other day, I put in small print and put this one in big print. Some people put a big pie there, and the big pie is basically these guys at 10% of the pie, and sporadic colorectal cancer is 90%. And that's why there's a lot of potential for identifying and modulating the risk factors for colon cancer. So back to our curve here and our paradigm for screening. And that's what we're going to quickly focus on now, is what is out there, what is involved for screening, and what is the impact that it's making on disease. Firstly, ulcerative colitis. And that was your question down there about Crohn's disease, ulcerative colitis of the colon. These folks have to be monitored very closely. There aren't too many of them out there. In fact, but what we have made a big difference is doing regular surveillance of their colon and doing a biopsy of their colon. And this is done at regular intervals. And so how do we know, how often should colonoscopies be performed? And this is the challenge. And what we're looking for, and this is the current recommendations that came out of the MD Anderson conference last week, is that this is suggested to practitioners for a high-risk population. We know that in almost certainty that if they are with a colon after 15 years, they are going to have colon cancer in there somewhere. It's no point just looking at the rectum with a flexible sigmoidoscopy, perhaps. You've got to look through the whole colon and see if you can detect cancer early, because early detection is going to make a major impact on survival. In fact, the strategy is to determine when is the colon to be removed, because what happens to these folks with long-standing ulcerative colitis is that we can avoid cancer by removing the colon. Not acceptable for the general population, but it gives us an insight from these regular colonoscopies as to what's happening within the colon. So should the colonoscopy, and they do biopsy of the mucosa of the colon, this is a concept that's going to be important in our understanding of colon cancer, is that they, under the microscope, can determine, this is HGD, is high-grade dysplasia or low-grade dysplasia, or, hey, can't make a call on it. And that is a histological call, and that determines by the picture under the microscope perhaps what's going on in the stages of colon cancer development, and I'll share our understanding of that shortly. So if it's negative, then 2 years is a reasonable interval for someone with ulcerative colitis. If there are starting to be flat mucosa but with high-grade dysplasia, then even because we don't know the rate things are going, determine a rate and see if there's consistency with low-grade dysplasia, in which case you go back to this algorithm, or if there's high-grade dysplasia, then that is significant indication that those cells are about to become cancerous. That's what dysplasia means, abnormal cells. And that is recommended that they, at that time, and it's usually around about age 15 years into the disease, that the colon be removed. But overall, if there's a question that's in between these two, then you want to try and get early detection. And so at 6 months, it's recommended. With low-grade dysplasia, it depends what the other findings are that are suspicious that clumps of cells are coming together to form colon cancer. Should it be flat with low-grade dysplasia, then continue to monitor. Particularly, the concern would be in a young patient because with the increased life expectancy, they will definitely get it if they have the organ removed. Colon cancer will definitely be prevented if the colon is removed. So that's one strategy, and one strategy, unfortunately, that's the best one because none of our treatments have made any impact on the development of ulcerative colitis, colorectal cancer and ulcerative colitis. So strategy one to reduce cancer incidence is to remove the colon. If you're without the organ, then you don't get it. Works. So where does our thinking come when it as to how colon cancer develops? And this is the model with which we work. Tau. And since I've indicated that there's changes within the cell, hasn't reproduced. Okay. This is high tech. It was from a book chapter and scanned into the computer. Learning to do this, it didn't reproduce too well, but hey, that's okay. This is now from the observations that we've made with ulcerative colitis, namely we see changes in cells, a concept that we have as to that natural history of disease. Because the question may be asked, who gets colon rectal cancer? Is it the gene? Is it the colon cell? Is it the colon crypt? Because if you're aware of the morphology of the colon, there's the crypt. Is it the organ? And then is it the individual? Or is it the population? And these are the various levels in which we have to consider colon cancer. So if anyone's exposed to a carcinogen, we see changes at the genetic material in the DNA in the nucleus of the cell. We would then call this an initiated cell. And so with these sorts of changes, these, although they haven't been completely characterized in ulcerative colitis, can be detected not only under the microscope for the dysplastic changes, but also we can measure some of the chromosomes and some of the genes within the chromosomes. We now have focus to where to look in the haystack. What we see throughout the colon is this concept of hyperproliferation of cells throughout the development of colon cancer or carcinogenesis. We see a group of cells, often within a lesion or within a crypt of the colon, and that's probably the earliest stage. And then we see what may be considered pre-neoplastic lesions, and with early detection and looking in the colon, we're seeing more of these, and we're trying to answer the question, what are they? And this is how we fit them into life. There are benign tumors, and that's what I would call polyps. And we now know that there are special characteristics of polyps, namely their histological type and their size, that if they're greater than 1 centimeter, they're more likely to be further down the line here. If they're of particular glandular type, namely a villous adenoma, they're more likely to go on to there, because not all of these tumors progress on. If you notice, this concept is a two-way street. So if we can identify factors to push things back here in spite of these initiations or activations, namely, I'm saying that we've got a now paradigm for identifying how disease progresses. There are factors going forward and there are factors going back. Given we smoke, or as I would suggest, as far as, and I'll share evidence shortly, that in the diet it's probably the cooking. Given our exposures, we can hold this back by other factors because they impact negatively, and that's probably where your fruits and vegetables come in, your high fiber diet. So that fat may be going towards this way and your fruits and vegetables coming back this way. If you want to look at it, and I've asked Ruth to reproduce an article there that has developed this heuristic approach, namely tying together these things at the molecular biological level and these things that we want to try and prevent that actually cause death or cancer. We're way back there on the natural history of disease. So what we have available to us is changes within the mucosa, and that's what we can see in ulcerative colitis, and that's why this concept has come through. If we take rectal biopsies, we can have a look at the crypt of the colon mucosa and work at the arrangement of cells within the mucosa and within the crypt. And we can get a very good handle as to what's going on in this concept of hyperproliferation. So this is way, way down the line, and we're not quite sure what it all means at this stage. But these are tools that we can measure. We can measure early. We can put in chemopreventative agents and try and push it back and change things here in the crypt. So that's our target. And that's available to us in short periods of time rather than the 20 years of time that it takes to develop colon cancer. So this is our progressive loss of control model. And we can make it rather sexy, and we can look at the genes of cells from here and here and here, and we've now got some understanding of what happens as cells proliferate and as they change into cancer. So there are factors occurring, what we call these genetic changes, at each of these levels that have been now identified over the last 5 to 7 years. It's really very, very exciting. This is what gets the news every day, because, hey, we're going to have a new screening test for colon cancer. We're going to be able to identify things. We're jumping ahead a little bit. But these are the concepts of which we're operating, and I wanted to share. We'll come back to this shortly and go back to the slides to show you where we're at in picking up these lesions, the adenomas and the colon cancers. So these tumors, if they're big enough, will bleed. And this is the stool guaiac test. We can either mail it out to the patient, or it can be done in the office. So there have to be, with the current guaiac testing, preparation. And the preparation is sort of 3 days before and during the testing, where you're getting stool samples, the patient should avoid, one, other sources of blood in the gastrointestinal tract, which is rare red meat. Two, substances that would interfere with the test, namely to give you a false positive. And these are the peroxidase containing vegetables, fruits. And these are broccoli, turnips, cantaloupe, cauliflower, and radish. So they all have this, which we react with guaiac. To overcome this problem now, we've developed more specific immunological agents that have antibodies for red cells specifically. But because this is a guaiac test, this chemical reaction needs to be controlled for. In addition, the patient should be off iron supplements, off iron, off aspirin, and other non-steroidals. So these are the important things for this screening test to detect blood. How should it be done? Two samples of each of three consecutive stools should be tested. And so the cards are done and they put in the mail and mailed off. The slides should be looked at within 4 to 6 days, so that they shouldn't stay around. And the slides should be not rehydrated prior to developing for the average risk, namely the general population. And if they are rehydrated, really the red meat must have been avoided. Otherwise, there are too many false positives. So with any screening test, there are false positives, and these are the reasons for a false positive test. On the other hand, this is the reason for a false negative. What we're looking at is the rate of blood loss from a cancer. And that's what we're looking for with this crude screening, namely way down to the right. If the lesion is in the ascending colon or in the cecum, there has to be significant blood loss. And what we're looking at there is around about 9.3 mils per day. If it's less than 9.3, we'll basically, if a standard test and then it's not rehydrated, have a false negative rate, namely we've missed the cancer, of 17%. If it's rehydrated, it's down to 4%. So the cancer can be there, but we've missed it because it isn't bleeding enough. If it's in the transverse colon and then down here, obviously less blood to be detected in the guaiac stool. So the sine qua non for the screening test is totally non-specific for colon cancer, because if you go and look at all the reasons why these are positive, they may have little leaky blood vessels, and that's quite common in the elder, arteriovenous malformations. There may be other inflammatory bowel lesions, other things, sure, that may be worthwhile to detect. But when it comes to developing cancer, and this is cancers only, they're more likely to bleed than the other lesion that you pick up, which is an adenoma. So this is an example of a major study screening an asymptomatic population of 107,000 folks, where they were randomized into the test group to have it done at every 2 years, 53,000, and a control group where they're just left on their own. This obviously took many years to perform, and there are now several in the literature, and I'll summarize those on the next slide. Left to their own devices, namely the control group, and those, obviously, these people who don't comply with the strategy for screening, and that obviously is 47% of the population. Can you see that's the respondents were 53%? Can you see that? So should it be positive? What was found? 2.3% of the population, or 618, had something there. What was there? 430 lesions. So there were, in that, between 618 and 430, other reasons. Other reasons, namely, it could have been dietary indiscretion, it could have been ulcerative colitis, it could have been other problems. How many cancers did they find? 63. And as you're aware already, when screening is in place, almost 77-80% were early Dukes A or B, namely cure could be obtained. So we're doing better, but we're only doing better in those who respond. 19% or 22% were Dukes C and D, remembering with a 5-year survival of around about 55%. Dukes A and B have cure. So that's an asymptomatic population. For those who weren't in the program, where were they? At least half were in that Dukes C and D in the non-responders, and a similar number, about half, were Dukes C and D in the control group. So what's concluded, and statistically, at this level, there's been significant shifting down that curve through screening, because curative surgery could be obtained in those who had positive hemocult testing. The other interesting thing that they found in there is this other thing, is the adenoma. And 76 of those, of the 367, were greater than 2 centimeters in polyp size, which means that those little nubbins there were significant risk for going on to developing colon cancer. So this is now our new strategy, is picking up one cancer and then picking up the precursor of cancer. Because this is a long-term study, at 2 years re-screening, again about 2%, 1.7% were hemocult positive, 7,000 of the 27,000. So even if they had participated in the program, they didn't always go back. So this is where we've got to be rather proactive in trying to get in compliance with a reasonable strategy. And re-screening again at 4 years down the line, another 2 years, less yield, 3%. So what this can interpret also is that we're reducing cancer. And basically down here, because of such small numbers, 3,000 folks, one cancer and 4 adenomas. So that really that first test down there makes a big difference. So the question now for public health is, how often should this be done? If it's done properly, then there's a good chance that there'll be a significant reduction in colorectal cancer. What are these precise recommendations? And they keep changing all the time, but it's definitely annually after the age of 50, because it's a cheap, cost-effective relative. People certainly do costing analysis, namely what does it cost to screen 107,000 people, actually the test group of 53,000. So that's the potential burden, but the benefit is reducing colon cancer. So in summary, of all the controlled trials for occult blood testing in asymptomatic patients for their positivity for colon cancer, this is Sweden, England, New York. I don't know if I can get this better focus for you. In large populations, compliance seems to be a major issue, varying from 50 to 70%. The Minnesota study is a major one. When you put that effort in, you have a positive test only in about 2%. And then its predictive value for either adenoma is around about 30%, for carcinoma around about 15%. And that you can, in the screened populations, come up with a potentially good outcome. So that's where we stand with hemocult testing. I've indicated that it's not specific and it can be a problem. It's not specific for colon cancer, and this is where the new direction is to have a look at the stools for other things, namely genes and cells. So this is what a polyp looks like, because obviously we need to move on here. This is a polyp with a stalk, And within one polyp, there can be abnormal areas, and you can have cancer in situ. And these are what are called crypts. So that's the paradigm. And so this is our experience over the last, from 1988 to 1992 at the VA hospital. Just to have a look before we start studies, what types of polyps are they? Predominantly, they are adenomatous polyps, namely what I just showed you. They are more cancerous if they're villoadenomatous, the more villo structure in them. Sometimes there may be cancer in situ. Where in the colon are they found? And this is basically the rectum, is number one. Number two is in the sigmoid. So these are readily detected by a flexible sigmoidoscopic exam. Flexible sigmoidoscope can go up to 60 centimeters. Unfortunately, there's the descending colon, the transverse colon, and the unspecified, well, sorry, let's forget the unspecified. That's those that we didn't know where they were. But nevertheless, polyps can occur throughout the length of the colon. That's why now the challenge is not flexible sigmoidoscopy, which can be done by internists. You need a colonoscopy exam by a gastroenterologist. How many should you have in your lifetime is now the question. Because this is another level of care that we've got. The most sensitive test for picking up cancer is going to be a colorectal, colonoscopic examination. So about 10 years ago, a multi-center trial followed patients for 8 years, and this just came out in 1991 in gastroenterology. And they looked at the cumulative incidence of colorectal cancer in patients with polyps. So these are folks who at, I think they were randomized, like the fecal testing, 2 years. The study design I don't have for you, but every 2 years they had exams of the colon. And what they observed in this population, in looking at their colon over 7 years, was a less than 1% incidence of colorectal cancer. Yes, ma'am?
What was the age? Was it age-adjusted?
For this group, for the National Polyp Studies, was over the age of 50. So it's a high-risk population, again, by that risk factor, age over the age of 50. So colonoscopy actually was performed, and they removed polyps. If you look for lesions 1 centimeter and greater and realize that you're like on a lunarscape as you go between folds of the colon, as you follow it around, it's quite likely that you're going to miss. But every 2 years, overall, they had a very low incidence of colorectal cancer because they removed what we call the precursor. What would have been expected was their calculation from historical information from their population and from St. Mark's Hospital in London and from the Mayo Clinic. Namely, these places would have expected over time to have this sort of incidence, around about 4% in the population for colorectal cancer in this age group. Removing a polyp reduced cancer. So on that screening line, that intervention, colonoscopy, has made a big difference as far as the incidence of cancer. You remove the cancer, you don't have the mortality figures from colorectal cancer. So that's strategy number two. Is identification of polyps by colonoscopy, and you can see you can get into that by doing stool screening, but that not all polyps bleed, and so you're going to miss a lot. So you've really got to go back to the gold standard. And now we're addressing training technicians to do colonoscopies, and people are out there training them. Does it make sense? Can we afford to do it? And then the question, as I indicated before, is after the age of 50, how many colonoscopies should you have? Should you have one? Should you have one every 8 years? Should you have one every 6 years? Should you have one every 3 years? The current recommendations came out, and it's once every 3 years. We're going to ask the question now is, can we, by taking pictures of the, or samples of the tissue of the of the colon from measuring proliferative indices, identify patients who are likely to develop polyps and colorectal cancer, or those who are not likely and therefore no need for annual, three-yearly, five-yearly, eight-yearly colonoscopies. That's a question that's out there. We really don't know. Actually, the VA has funded a study, a long-term study, to try and answer that question. And they're just going to follow those patients who don't have polyps, because polyps come back, folks, because this is part of the sequence. The cells in the colon that I showed you on this overhead is that cells develop into small polyps and then bigger polyps. And that's why we remove the bigger ones. And if we remove them, we make an impact on the incidence of the disease. So what causes cancer? And I guess that was my cue here, because I think we're running back or running out of time. I was wanting to share some of the evidence of these environmental factors. But this is what we understand by the causes of colon cancer in 1993. One, and those of you who've had training in public health realize that we've developed, and epidemiology can help us develop hypotheses. We now, with colon cancer, have the tools to test the hypotheses. And I was going to briefly summarize for you, and I've got the tables and slides, where this comes from. Ecological means just observing the population, observing countries. Case control means finding patients who have colon cancer and then going into your records and finding patients matched for age and sex and then comparing information. What are they comparing? They're comparing dietary information. These studies were done way back and our ways of measuring the diet then were not good. So case control studies are along the scale, but they've helped to develop an understanding of a high-fat diet and low-fiber diet causes colon cancer. A cohort study, and that's been available to us over the last 10 years, is a prospective study of a population looking at their dietary habits at the beginning rather than the end when, as in the case control, you analyze the diet after they've developed colon cancer. Prospectively, you can follow a population, and there are now numerous studies, some of which the results have been out in the last couple of years. And briefly, you look at the dietary risk and dietary habits and then follow the population with over time, monitoring their diet by what's called a semi-quantitative food frequency questionnaire. And from that data, you can break down into nutrients, into foods, and to eating patterns, and come up with risk factors to develop. And again, this is strongly supportive of a high-fat diet and a low-fiber diet. The most recent one has broken it down, is looking at the nurses. Is everyone familiar with the nurses study? Do you want to share with us what you understand by the nurses study? It wasn't specifically an intervention, namely it's an observational. Epidemiological studies are at this level, they picked out habits, and one of those was vitamin supplements, and one of those vitamin supplements was beta carotene. Actually, beta carotene is a nutrient that can be calculated out of the semi-quantitative food frequency. So the nurses study in 1981, they all filled out, 60,000 nurses filled out their diet. And then they've been monitored every 2 years by mailing out and sending back, and we can scan these now. We don't have to have students writing all the data down. And basically, we can get a lot of data on 60,000 people. And then look at those cases down the line that develop in our monitoring of their health status, those who have disease X, Y, and Z. And we're going down the list now for coronary artery disease and colon cancer. And colon cancer, beta carotene has come out. The same study has been done in health professionals, which is majority of physicians. And the two interesting things that have come out of that is one, red meat. And it may not be fat, it may be red meat. And I'm going to share with you a cooking story shortly, if it's underdone, then probably okay. So it may not be the fat, but these are hypotheses that can be tested, cohort studies. The other interesting thing that's in there is aspirin. If you take more than 15 aspirin a day, you have reduced colon cancer. And that came out in August of this year. And I'll share. Yes, ma'am?
More than how much aspirin?
15 aspirin a month.
Oh, okay.
Don't take 15 a day, thank you very much. Otherwise, you will get a colonoscopy for sure. We're trying to develop strategies now to decrease the need for high-cost tech, or high-tech and high-cost healthcare. So we now have in place, and as we found out down in Houston last week, that there are about 20 or so interventions, namely not the observation, but actually prospectively knowing what people are eating, following what they're eating, and then doing an intervention. In our case, we're happy to increase the fiber diet by giving them a fiber supplement, cellulose. The physiological basis and hypothesis, that's going to be in the article that I'll be sharing with you. Did Ruth get them copied? And that is another story. The other component of the story is the colonic milieu, namely, guess who's in there? That's a world unto itself in the gastrointestinal tract, and there's about 200 to 300 grams of bacteria in the colon. And so our little friends down there live in an environment that we provide here, and so people are trying to pull that all together, and the article that I'll share with you will discuss that. And then this one is the really testable one that we've got available to us, because we can't wait for our dietary interventions for patients to get cancer. What we can do, because we know polyps come back, and we believe this is the sequence, and in fact, the natural history of polyps is that if you remove them, well, if you don't remove them, they develop cancer. And that's probably the case in 70 to 80% of the situations, because cancer can just appear for whatever reason. So that sequence is known. Furthermore, they come back. And because they come back, we can try and reduce the rate at which they come back. And that's our strategy with dietary intervention. Because we've got to survive in the academic world, we want to look at them every year. We know that polyps come back every, there's about a 40% recurrence rate at 3 years. 40% will come back. Maybe a little bit lower, 30 to 35% is probably the upper limit, if you want to write that down. So what we've got to try and work out is what's going on in the mucosa, that those proliferative changes, are they related to the sequence? And that can now be tested in humans. And we hope to be able to turn down proliferation by a dietary intervention. So we now have theories of colon cancer, both a model to be tested in humans, because I was going to show you rat data, and there's no way that we're going to be able to do that in the time available. But based on animal research, that's certainly testable, and we can control the amount of fiber, the amount of fat, we can control the fiber type and all sorts of things and get a very specific handle. But what you and I eat is dietary patterns and dietary and foods. And what we should be doing is a little bit of an uncertainty. But I think there's some very clear recommendations that could be made. So avoidance of risk factors, and that's the high-fat diet and the low-fiber diet. And interventions, and I've indicated that there are studies there now for chemo prevention, and one of those is the aspirin story. There are those groups, and those patients with familial polyposis have their colons removed, but they leave in place the rectum. And the rectum has a lot of polyps, and you can see them. And if you put them on wheat bran, vitamin C, or the antioxidants, you can markedly reduce the number of those polyps. If you put them on aspirin or Sulindac, they just melt away. And so there's a lot of science there that people are trying to understand that. These anti-inflammatory agents can melt away the sequence. So that sequence, the two-way stretch, can be pushed back to the left. And the dietary modifications is low fat, and just to let you know, and high fiber. It's an extension of the National Polyp Study. There's now in place a population of 2,000 folks identified. It's 1,900 at the moment. By December, it's going to be 2,000. And they're going to randomize them into a major dietary pattern change. They're going to go into low-fat diet, hopefully, and a high-fiber diet. And they're going to see what happens to their polyps over time and obviously look at these proliferative changes of what we call biomarkers. We decided not to be part of that, but to look at specific fiber type. And we obviously don't have time to go into that epidemiological data, but all that I can say at the moment is that there's a question as to which fibers we should be increasing in our diet as well. So that's our strategies. Let's focus here, and that's where our energies are going. And this is just summary of Doyle's data. There's a significant component of avoidability of cancer through lifestyle changes. I will leave it there, not go into any of the epidemiological data. The references are in Dr. Potter's article that I have shared with you, because he's tried to bring together the hypotheses that have been generated from epidemiology to the cell and actually the gene. So that's some bedtime reading for you. What we're going to do is intervene in patients in the San Antonio area with cellulose, measuring their mucosa and their indices of proliferation in the mucosa of the cell. So we're pretty excited, and there are other centers around the country that are doing this sort of work with Sulindac, with vitamin E, with vitamin A is another one that's being tested. Another one that's been of benefit is calcium supplementation. So how this all fits in raises more questions and generates jobs for more researchers. I'll leave it at that and entertain any questions.
Yes? How about vitamin A as prevention of not only cancer, not only some other types of cancer in the gastrointestinal tract? I read some about and also that's why they're pushing more vegetables and diets.
Yeah. Yeah. What's very exciting, I think it was in the last month, our colleagues in China have a cancer that's just unheard of as far as proportion of the population. We're talking about incidence of disease in the US population. It's almost 60% of the population has this esophageal cancer in certain province in China. And it's probably related to their eating habits and pickled foods and different things like that. What they did was a dietary intervention. And it was antioxidants, which was selenium and vitamin C and vitamin E and vitamin A and zinc. And they actually gave them multivitamin tablet and minerals tablet. And because of the way they randomized it and did it scientifically in obviously a large number of people, they reduce the incidence of cancer, esophageal cancer, through dietary supplementation. It may be, because it wasn't a perfect study, that they were deficient in vitamin A and these other antioxidants, and that's obviously the implications of the study. It may be that vitamin A is a chemotherapeutic agent interfering with other things. So we've got more questions from that type of dietary intervention study, because all it did was give a pill to somebody, same as we're giving a pill of vitamin supplement, of fiber supplement. So what actually happens is we have a handle that nutrients, single nutrients, maybe actual chemotherapeutic agents. What does it mean for us? Nothing. It just gives us further insight to colon cancer. For the people in China, it means a lot, because it's reduced esophageal cancer. Living without an esophagus is a big problem. So we're now at disease prevention at high-risk groups. That high-risk group, whether it's because they have a cooking methods or whether it's because they don't have a good diet, other people are going to go back and have a look. But those sorts of studies now can be done with that as an endpoint. What we're having a look at for an endpoint is recurrence of polyps in another high-risk group. So these are the prevention strategies and what the future holds. Yes, ma'am.
I have a couple of questions. First is,
Yes.
Is the incidence, if at age 70 is the first time they have a scope, and there are no polyps, is there some way to tell if they're ever going to develop colon cancer? Is it higher risk as if they have their first scope at 50?
That's one of the reasons why some of the studies are being done. If you've got a clean colon at age 70, the probability is going to be very low. And so people are trying to work out how many colonoscopies should you have in your life. If they didn't have one at age 50 and they didn't, and their first one's age 70, then probabilities are fine, they won't need another one. Yeah, fat tastes good. Fat provides calories. What we're seeing, and I probably should put up the sort of healthy recommendations for a diet. If we could go to the last, that's the last or the second last slide. A high fiber diet can be made tasty. That's a challenge to healthcare professionals in the nursing homes. I'm not going around making recommendations that we've got to make big changes. We've got to do things gradually at a population level and then the specific nursing home level. Those risk factors, while they may have been exposed to them for 70 years, it may be that they don't have the genes that are going to be turned on by those sorts of risk-taking behaviors. And that's why we're doing this sort of research, to see early what do we understand in the sequence that benefits or hinders the process. Sorry, can we ask the other lady? She's got a question first, and then we can go back.
Kind of spacing, because some of the older patients are not going to like that much chewing that much process from a lot of the high fiber. So would they be in a study where they're going to be adding high fiber?
Those studies are being done. Why we're doing these studies is to try and convert humans into laboratory animals, to get back to these sorts of recommendations for the population from the Academy of Sciences, Cancer Society, US and Canada, American Heart Association, the NCI. These all merge for the general population for health. And basically what we're looking at is variety of foods, and all of these things are for experimental purposes. Can you each read? Can you read that? Or? So it's basically, the strategy is, if it was going back, is to have increased vegetables, fruits, and whole grains. And US diet probably provides in the order of about 12 grams of fiber a day. We probably need to be up 30 grams of fiber a diet, and that evidence is referenced in the article that I have made available. What we're looking at is increasing vegetable products, legumes, fruits, vegetables, and cereals and breads. And there's a consensus from each of these organizations. I think there's maybe one more slide after this, that for dietary recommendations. That was the joke. Because the side effect of all of this is that you do, and I've actually heard a gentleman discuss Dr. Dennis Burkett. He was a surgeon, a missionary surgeon in Africa in the 1960s, and actually he came up with the hypothesis that he saw no colon cancer in Africa. And actually, if you went to his home in England, he would have a stool measuring device in his bathroom, and you had to log in if you were a house guest. And this was his conclusion from his studies. If you increase the fruits and vegetables, you'll certainly markedly increase the fiber in your diet. And this may make a lot of sense, but we don't have scientific proof yet. And so what do we do when we're caring for patients? We do what's prudent, and that is the recommendations that we saw in those from the national organizations. Because basically, in our nursing homes, and the older, the major problem is constipation. And that may be a function of low fiber. The other interesting factor that's come out from these studies is physical activity. I told you about aspirin that's coming through in these sorts of studies. Physical activity is in there, in the equation somewhere. Increased activity, levels of activity, decrease colon cancer. What these lifestyle factors mean, people can guess, but we really don't know. But that's certainly in there. The dietary factors and exercise are coming together, coronary artery disease and colon cancer. Two other questions, ma'am. Sorry.
Whenever you find cancer in the colon,
yes.
Is the entire colon removed? What percentage?
Oh, no. That's why I was talking about staging. And so they resect where the cancer is and around it until it's free. And unfortunately, those Dukes C and D, it spread beyond the mucosa. I didn't show you pictures of tumors. And then it may be in lymph nodes, and so it's spread elsewhere.
Okay, but if you just have a resection, what is the percentage of recurrence in another area?
Yeah, this is a high-risk population. And that's, if you think of that carcinogenesis, these people are predetermined. And it may be that there's something in the haystack that we haven't found yet. And given the right environment, that will occur. But the people who have colorectal cancer and are Dukes A and B, and you think they're cute, can develop a second cancer, and a significant proportion do, and it's probably as high as 20%. So this comes into our concept of screening, and that is really now secondary prevention, and it's called surveillance. Really, you're not looking for recurrence of cancer, you're looking for another primary. Same as with the adenoma patient, you're looking for the polyp that was missed and subsequent ones that are going to develop.
My other question is that someone said that those scopes are only cold sterilized. Is that true?
Oh, we have technology now where it's Side-X and it's gas and chemical environment, and that's high tech now, and it's a major industry to come up with stuff that doesn't ruin your colonoscopes, because they're $5,000 each, and sterilization is a major problem, particularly if we look at the diseases that are out there, and the disease that resides in the gastrointestinal tract is the HIV virus. So yeah, that's one of the pushes, both the cost and the risks, which always have to be taken into consideration. The cost for detecting a cancer is why we want to get down further on disease prevention. And that's why it still may be a little bit of apple pie. What we know works is hemocult testing in a high-risk population and colonoscopy in a very high-risk group, which is those with cancer, because they have regular colonoscopies, and in a moderate-risk group, those with adenomas. Oh yeah, oh yeah. But they all adhere to current consensus conferences and the state of the art. And same as our concerns for blood banks and transmission of disease through blood products, the same is required of our healthcare professionals who invade our bodies, if you want, so to speak. That's an assumption, and assumption that probably shouldn't take. Any other questions? Thank you for your attention.